welcome to another essential lecture in Jewish history. Today we're going to focus on a very important aspect of Jewish intellectual history. We're going to look at the period known as the period of the Rishonim, or the first ones. It's an exceptionally important aspect of understanding how Jewish intellectual history develops and how really the massive corpus of rabbinic literature works by understanding what exactly was this period of the Rishonim. So let's go straight to the present. Here we go. Here's a basic fundamental idea that is deeply ingrained in the Jewish psyche and is very much a relevant aspect of contemporary Jewish hermeneutics, particularly within the traditional Orthodox way of looking at the universe. Specifically, there is this idea known as Yeridas Hadoros, or decline of the generations. There is this concept that from the moment that God gave the Torah to the Jews on Mount Sinai, it's been all downhill. As my father used to say all the time, Henry, it just gets worse. So the idea is that on Sinai, the Jews reached a spiritual peak and their sensitivity to the divine message was at its highest. And as the Talmud says, the Midrash actually, you know, at Sinai, even the lowest household servant saw things that even the great prophet Ezekiel did not see. But ever since then, we have been slowly losing that ability to be sensitive to the divine message. We have been losing our level of spiritual ability to understand the meaning of these classical texts and so on, and we have been struggling to try and tread water all the way along. That does not mean that our intellectual skills have diminished, and in fact, this is not time to go off on a great digression here, but when it comes to halakhic decisions, that is, decisions referring to Jewish law, one must follow contemporary opinions, even though the earlier opinions, you know, have this weight of being from an earlier generation. That said, it's not exactly a steady slope downward. It's kind of like stepped plateaus, and the Jewish religious and intellectual tradition generally recognizes several key periods of Jewish spiritual decline, and they correspond to, let's say, the following four periods that I've outlined on this slide. There is the period known as the period of the Amoraim, or the speakers. This refers to the era in which the Talmud was written, roughly the 3rd through the 6th centuries, give or take 100 years. Following the period of the Amoraim are the Geonim, which is a difficult term to translate. It's based on the word pride, so I've given the definition here of prides, but really it means like glorious ones or great ones, that kind of thing. You may have heard the term the Gaon of Vilna or the Vilna Gaon. That's the correct usage of the term. It's a title for Rabbi Eliyahu of Vilnius. But that term is used anachronistically, meaning he was so great, he was like one of the Gaonim, even though he lived, you know, over a century later, or almost a century later. No, actually over a century. Then we have the period that we'll talk about today. That is of the Rishonim, the first ones. The word Rishon in Hebrew means first. And that spans roughly 900 to 1500, although there's some, you know, kind of pedantic dispute over exactly when that period begins and when it ends. And then finally, the period of the Acharonim, the later ones, which goes up to roughly the year 1900. And it has not yet been determined what do we call contemporary 20th or 21st century thinkers, but that's kind of like the nature of Jewish history. The arc of Jewish history, as they say, is long, and these things will be decided over time. So let's focus in on point number 3, the period of the Rishonim. The names, if you had any familiarity with the Jewish religious tradition, you'll certainly recognize them. There are perhaps a few dozen, maybe 100 at most, authors who correspond to this title, the Rishonim. But to choose 3 of the most famous, there are, of course, Rashi, Rabbi Shlomo Yitzchaki, who lived in the 11th century. Here is an extremely accurate picture of Rashi. I'm just kidding. We have no idea if this is accurate, but it's a representation that's often used in an iconic form. And I'll speak in the next slide a little bit about what was the kind of work that Rashi did. Secondly, the incomparable Maimonides, known by the acronym of his name, Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon. He lived in the following century, the 12th century. Here is another equally accurate rendition. I really like this one, especially kind of like the view of the background. We have no idea if the Rambam looked like this, but nevertheless, this is sort of like the iconic image that you'll see all over Israel and things like that. And finally, not a single individual, rather a school of Rishonim known as Tosafot, which means literally additions, and they are, that's referring to their contribution as additional to the work of Rashi. So if we look, for example, here at a page of Talmud, this is a great page which is taken off the web, it's colorized here. Let's walk through it very quickly and we'll see where they fit in. So the sort of coral color number one in the center is the Mishnah. This is the first page of Tractate Brachot, and we spoke about the Mishnah in an earlier essential lecture. Then directly below it in the center of the page, number two in yellow, that is the Gemara or Talmud per se. That is the commentary on the Mishnah. And then the blue on the right, number three, that is the commentary of Rashi. If you look closely, you'll see that in this particular printing, this looks like the Talmud edition, some passages are bolded and some are not bolded. They are written in the characteristic italic font that has been associated with Rashi ever since. It's known as Rashi script, although it was just a common font used, a typescript and a hand script written in the medieval period. Anyways, sorry for that digression. You'll see that the some passages are bolded and others are not in bold and regular font. This gives you an indication as to what Rashi is doing. The bolded passages are quotations from number one and number two, from the Mishnah and the Talmud, and then his comment follows in regular font. So Rashi is kind of providing this incredible service, walking the reader through the text, phrase by phrase, with pithy little comments that in a very, very economical use of words express what the text is meaning. So Rashi is an incredible aid to understanding the Talmud. He also wrote an incredible commentary on the Chumash, or the first five books of the Torah, as well as the entire Tanakh, actually, that really helps a reader walk through the difficult language at a very, very basic level. And Rashi is, of course, essential to the curriculum in modern Jewish schools. Then number four on the outside, that's actually, they blocked out a lot of different things here, but the actual column that the number four appears in, which you can see is sort of like C-shaped, and it wraps around the top and the bottom a little bit, that's actually Tosafot. These are additions to Rashi. And if you look carefully, you'll see that the amount of bolded text is much less than in Rashi, because Tosafot is performing an entirely different function. Tosafot is analyzing the Talmud itself, raising objections, comparing passages elsewhere in the Talmud to the spot on this page and so on, and really taking an entirely different approach to Talmud than Rashi, the predecessor. Tosafot represents, you know, several dozen scholars that lived through roughly the 12th through the 14th centuries, and their ideas are kind of codified into the page here. Now, the other materials around the outside are various other commentators that go all the way from the 10th century up to, it looks like about the 18th century is represented here, and they perform various functions. You'll see my lecture on the Talmud if you're curious about this in a little greater detail. Right, let's go on. So those are three very basic, famous Rishonim. There are dozens more. Now, what exactly did the Rishonim do? What is characteristic of this period in Jewish intellectual history? Well, the first thing I've already alluded to in the previous slide, some of the Rishonim were incredible explainers. They took texts, often ancient texts like the Torah and the Mishnah, and they basically rendered them in more readily understandable Hebrew. Many of those texts are written not in Hebrew. They're written in Aramaic, for example. The Talmud is written in Aramaic. So there was a lot of, you know, confusion about the language itself. But more significantly, unpacking the arcane and coded nature of many of these texts, synthesizing the oral and the written tradition, that's especially something that Rashi did tremendously, and generally making the text, which at this point may have been over 1,000 years old, accessible to medieval readers. Nowadays, of course, you know, the decline of generation is certainly true. Many of us require an English translation to access the Rishonim, who are helping us access the original text, but that's essentially what they're doing. If you want a contemporary example, Rashi was, so to speak, the art scroll of his day. That is a phenomenal compliment to art scroll, right? Rashi was the mediator that made a lot of those ancient texts accessible to medieval readers. Secondly, very importantly, the Rishonim engaged in codification. And this is a larger topic. Basically, Jewish law or halakha is spread out throughout a massive amount of literature. It's throughout this huge Talmud. There are passages that are derived from the Tanakh, and of course from the Torah itself, and the commentaries of the Gaonim, their correspondence, known as Teshuvot and so on. And a lot of this material, you know, is just too much for most people to keep in their heads. So therefore, a lot of the Rishonim, most famously perhaps Maimonides, brought all of this together and said, look, we're going to reorganize this, and we are going to space it out, give it chapter headings, give it subject headings, so that you can look up in these massive compendiums of Jewish law exactly the law that you want to determine. You don't have to go back through the entire Talmud, which at this point, remember, had not been indexed in any reasonable fashion. The Rishonim did a lot of that really basic legwork of codifying all of that material. Maimonides is, I mentioned, probably one of the most important codifiers of the era. He wrote a book called the Mishneh Torah, or 14 volumes of Jewish law. And you have other commentaries which culminate in this work, the Shulchan Aruch, or the Set Table. This is written at the very end of the period of Rishonim. Some would even consider the author, Rabbi Yosef Karo, an early Acharon. But basically, this is the authoritative code that upon which all later codes have been built. So that's the second major activity of the Rishonim. First is basically they were explainers. Second major issue was they were codifiers of the various commandments. And the final area that you find the commentators working on is they are analyzers. For example, one of the areas in which the Rishonim expressed themselves was in the area of minyan hamitzvot, the counting of the commandments. The Talmud has a passage that says there are 613 commandments, tarayag mitzvot. That's a lot more than the big 10, right? The Judaism has a huge amount of commandments. And, you know, like, thou shalt feel guilty. No, I'm joking. I shouldn't say that. Why am I saying these things? So they have all these commandments, but nowhere in the Talmud or in any other text were they ever actually listed. And so many of the commentators in the Rishonim period began to say, okay, well, let's get them all down. What are those 613 commandments? And so Maimonides and others compiled these lists. There were some disputes over this is not actually a commandment, this is actually a suggestion, things like that. But basically, one of the major activities is counting of the mitzvot. And in particular, this book, here's a Hebrew English edition published in the 20th century by Feldheim, the Sefer Achinuch, an amazing work that's written by a later Rishon, probably one Rabbi Aaron of Barcelona, who lived in the 15th century. This is a great book if you want a general introduction to traditional Judaism. Basically, what he did was he anonymously wrote this book as a bar mitzvah present. I mean, oh my gosh. When I was growing up, you know, bar mitzvah presents were fountain pens. My sons generally got things like iPods. But back then in the 15th century, this was taka, an amazing birthday present. It's basically it goes through every parsha of the Torah, you know, the five books of Moses as they're divided over the weeks of the year. And in each of those parshiot, the author lists the commandments, all adding up to 613, describes how they are performed, a little bit of historical background, and then really interestingly, he talks about why we have this commandment. This is an area of activity that most of the Rishonim shy away from, at least in print. They don't talk about, you know, the commandments are there. God says do it, and that's all there is to it. But the Chinuch was very interested in giving over to his son, as a bar mitzvah present, some inkling as to why these commandments exist. And it's really fascinating reading, especially when you get to the arcane and strange commandments, like, for example, you shall not mix linen and wool together, things like that. Fascinating reading and definitely very worthwhile. Another philosophical activity that's extremely important is that of Maimonides. Again, we're mentioning him over and over again because he is such a towering figure in medieval Jewish history. This is a picture, an illuminated manuscript of his Mora Nevuchim, his Guide for the Perplexed, in which the artist has depicted here Maimonides seated on the right, wearing tefillin, instructing his students in philosophy. And this is something that only a few of the Rishonim really engaged in, an area which is known in contemporary Hebrew as machshava, as thought, which basically expands on this idea of the why. Why did God create the world the way it's created? Why do we have these obligations? How does it all work? And so on. And the Mora Nevuchim, or the Guide to Perplex, is one of these great philosophical works for which, of course, Maimonides was heavily criticized by other Jews. And in fact, his book was even burned in the 13th century, not a particularly high point in Jewish intellectual history. Now, that's basically a quick overview of the Rishonim. We understand them a little better, especially when we contrast them with the later period, the Acharonim. The Rishonim have a pride of place, again, going back to that concept of Yeridat HaDorot, the decline of the generations, because they come earlier than the Acharonim. And their activity, particularly in codification, in explaining the text and so on, give them a huge pride of place in the traditional yeshiva curriculum even today. Acharonim, picking up afterwards, generally spent a lot of energy trying to explain the Rishonim, synthesizing their work, and in some cases, adapting their ideas, which are expressed in theory, to novel situations that occur in the contemporary period. Changes in social norms, changes in economic realities, changes in technology in particular, are very much the activity of the Acharonim, trying to understand, for example, what does electricity mean when it comes to Shabbat? Can one use distance communication to fulfill a mitzvah like hearing the shofar? All kinds of interesting things like this. That's more the domain of the Acharonim, and particularly the later contemporary thinkers, 21st and 20th century as well. So that's a quick overview of who the Rishonim are and what they engaged in, and it's an especially fascinating part of Jewish intellectual history. Thanks very much for watching.